Good morning. I'm Pastor Jeff at Bailey Dye Methodist Church, and I welcome you to our virtual worship service. If you would like more information, if you'd like a bulletin for this service or more information about the church, then you can go to bit.ly/bailchurchinfo and find lots of great stuff there. We invite you to enter your name in the chat and say hi to everybody and engage and celebrate and fellowship together. And now, let us turn our hearts to worship Almighty God.
Good morning. I am Judy Jollett, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to Vail Church this morning. We are so glad that you are with us to worship and gather together here. Rules. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist movement, simplified how to follow God into three simple rules. Do no harm, do good, and attend to the ordinances of God, or stay in love with God. We have spent the last 3 weeks exploring our Methodist roots and how our tradition informs our living today. This week, we will finish our series as we explore what it means as a United Methodist to see the entire world as our church community. Have you ever met an extrovert? These are the people who can be doing absolutely anything in absolutely any location and make friends with the people around them. Extroverts are great at embarrassing their introverted children and peers. They walk into a restaurant, by the end of the meal, can tell you the entire life history of the waitstaff. Putting ourselves out there to share our faith with the world may seem scary, or like the world's greatest thrill-seeking ride, depending on your personality. John Wesley agreed that this could be overwhelming. He was raised to believe that preaching happened inside the church walls only. But he also realized that the common people of 18th century England were unable to worship on Sunday mornings, so the only way they could get to church was as if church went to them, wherever they happened to be. God calls us beyond our comfort zones to make disciples of all for the transformation of the world. Where are you being called to serve? Please join us as we turn our hearts to worship God. O Triune God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer. God beyond us, God with us, God ever among us. You are one God in three persons, ever entwined in a dance of grace. Get us on our feet today that we may join the dance and give you glory in word, in deed, and in song. Amen.
God of grace and God of glory.
Through this Methodist movement, we have been called to serve the world, trusting the love of God to make all things new as we serve one another. Let us confess our sins to God and our neighbor. God of mercy, your command to love one another across all differences opens us up to new horizons. Yet we often respond with fear and judgment that hinders your goal for humanity. Forgive our sins, we pray, and give us a true repentance that leads to life for all creation. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us take a moment of silent reflection. Hear the good news. God's promises are trustworthy and true. Your sins are forgiven. Be at peace to serve the Lord, and may you always be known by your love. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen and amen. Have you ever had the urge to contact someone you haven't talked to in a long time? This itch may sit for a second or persist for several days, but the need to hear from them and see what is happening becomes a curiosity that can lead toward renewed relationship and care of one another. These impulses to reach out are as old as time. Hear from the 16th chapter in the book of Acts, how one such urge or vision led Paul to move to another region to share the love of God in Macedonia. A vision of a man from Macedonia came to Paul during the night. He stood urging Paul, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." Immediately after he saw the vision, "We prepared to leave for the province of Macedonia," concluding that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We sailed from Troas straight for Samothrace and came to Neapolis the following day. From there, we went to Philippi, a city of Macedonia's first district and a Roman colony. We stayed in that city several days. On the Sabbath, we went outside the city gate to the riverbank, where we thought there might be a place for prayer. We sat down and began to talk with the women who had gathered. One of those women was Lydia, a Gentile God worshiper from the city of Thyatira, a dealer in purple cloth. As she listened, the Lord enabled her to embrace Paul's message. Once she and her husband were baptized, she urged, "Now that you have decided that I am a believer in the Lord, come and stay in my house." And she persuaded us. A word of God that is still speaking. Thanks be to God.
Paul was called by God to go beyond his usual territory. And, you know, God does that a lot. Where are your limits? Where are your comfort zones? And where is God calling you to go beyond those for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Let's take a look. Will you pray with me? And now, O Lord, let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So Paul was traveling through Galatia, and he had this vision to go further up into Macedonia. This is now northern Greece. And according to the text, he went immediately. He didn't hesitate. He just went. This was quite a bit of traveling. This is not Jewish territory. But he went and he arrived and he went looking for a synagogue. But he only found a group of people who were worshiping God by the riverside, by the gate there. Perhaps some of them were Jewish, probably several of them were Jewish, but not necessarily all of them. And in fact, one of them was not, and that was Lydia. Now Lydia, there's a lot in this, just a little bit here, and a lot is said by it not being said. Lydia was a very important person. She was an independent businesswoman. There's no male mentioned here. No husband, no father, brother, anything like that. It is all the relationship with her. And that was quite unusual for that day and age. It says she was a dealer in purple cloth. And when I first read that, I was thinking, okay, she ran a fabric store. No, that's not it. Purple for clothing, the dye was very difficult to get. You had to crush up snails, and it was long and processed, very expensive, but also very beautiful. And Roman law dictated how much purple a person was allowed to wear. And the more purple you were allowed to wear, the higher your status was, or well, the other way, actually. And so don't think fabric store owner, think Rolls Royce dealer. She certainly connected with the rich and famous in the community. She was a Gentile. And yet, she was called a God worshiper, and some of our translations say God fearer, someone who was seeking a deeper relationship with God. And this is we see this phrase throughout the Gospels, throughout the New Testament. And sometimes it is people that eventually convert to Judaism. Others just not quite ready to go that far. Don't think they should go quite that far for whatever reasons. But she hears Paul's word and she responds. Her entire household is baptized. And she reaches out to Paul and says, "Paul, come and stay with us." And, you know, the text, oh, yeah, Paul did. Well, it's not always that simple. I mean, here's Paul and his traveling companions. Now, nowhere in Scripture is Paul's wife mentioned. In fact, at one point he says he does not have a wife. So there's no wife traveling with him. Some scholars say, well, you know, to be where he was, he would have had to have had a wife. But we don't know that. Anyway, she's not here with him if he was ever married. So this group of men and this independent woman invites them to come and stay with them. And yet Paul does. Well, actually, they even had the conversation in public, broke down a few barriers. Single women did not speak to strange men. But Paul did. And he was willing to reach beyond his work with Jews to connect with this Gentile woman.
the ministry was blessed. Now, God often calls us to go beyond our human imposed boundaries. John Wesley had this happen to him a lot because he pushed a lot of boundaries. Last week, I talked about Bible Moss, how he and some of his other seminary students wanted to study and learn more than what the curriculum was giving them. And so they gathered on a regular basis for Bible study. And some of their classmates, their other students, called them Bible Moss in a very derogatory way. But he wanted revival. And he went out and he preached, he proclaimed, and he began building these Methodist societies, all within the part of the Church of England, the Anglican Church, trying to revive it and encourage and build the church. One of his friends was George Whitefield. It's spelled Whitefield, but it's actually pronounced Whitefield. And Whitefield was out there preaching. He went out to where the people were. They called it field preaching. And he was, people were hearing. He came over to the United States, and it was a rock concert tour. You can, if you do much study of religion in the early Americas, you'll see Whitefield and what he did. You'll see the Methodist too, but you'll see Whitefield. And Wesley just rubbed him the wrong way. He called it a vile practice. He thought preaching needed to be in the church, in that rigid environment. But he began to see the practicality of it. People weren't coming to church. They were working. They couldn't get there. They were doing other things. And so he began to change his ways. And he took up this vile practice of field preaching. He'd preach in Market Square, as one account has him preaching to over 3,000 people. That's pretty tough. He'd preach in graveyards because that was a good place for a flat place for people to gather and to be heard. And he traveled throughout England, encouraging, teaching, exhorting. Now, In the Anglican Church at that time, you know, the country was the state religion, and so, you know, churches were assigned as parishes and kind of territories, boundaries. I mean, we here at Vail have kind of a, you know, I kind of give us an area that we mostly cover, but it's certainly, if someone shows up to the door, I don't ask them where they live. Oh, you know, you've got to go over to that church. Well, that was more the practice then. The Catholic Church does that somewhat today, not as much as they used to. These boundaries and barriers. And Wesley was going out, breaking those barriers, going about. And a lot of his colleagues were upset by that. They told him to stay in his lane, or, well, stay in his parish is what they said. And he responded, "No, the world is my parish. God works beyond our human imposed boundaries." Those boundaries are all around us. It's hard to see them sometimes. We live in a world where people like to create them. You know, they'll take a social concept or a group of people and demonize them. It's, oh, you know, they are all like this one person who's a bad character. I'm not saying that person didn't do something wrong. But just because you look like them doesn't mean you'll do the wrong too. And they want to put those barriers up. Oh, those people over there. Oh, not us. We're good. Build those barriers. And people feel like that's protection, but it's not. It's cutting down God's work. And God wants us to break those down, to see past those labels, those limits. And reach out in God's love and grace that they may hear the good news, that we too may hear it for ourselves and be transformed by it. John Wesley did not agree with George Whitefield on everything. In fact, he strongly opposed him on issues of Calvinism, you know, predestination and things like that, and would write tracts against George Whitefield. But he didn't demonize him. He didn't shut him off. In fact, Wesley preached Whitfield's funeral. He recognized the work he was doing for the gospel, for the work that God had done through Whitfield. God was greater than those differences that they might have. That's a good lesson for us. Today, the Methodist Church is a global organization, and it's sad to know that they missed that question on Jeopardy last week. I don't know if you saw that, but all three of them could not come up with Methodism from John and Charles Wesley, but oh well. Anyway, and there are lots of flavors of Methodists throughout the world. The United Methodist Church is the largest Methodist group, but there are certainly others. Reverend Sam Neesmith, who was actually my pastor when I was growing up, would take teams to Russia through United Methodist Volunteers in Mission. And I got to go with him once in summer of 2001. And we went to the United Methodist Church there in Moscow. And the preacher there, the pastor there, had been a KGB agent. And when Sam had brought a previous team, or others had brought a previous team there, she had been their guide. They knew what was going on, but they reached out and loved to her, and they gave her a copy of a Bible. And one night at 3 in the morning, she started pounding on the preacher's door. She'd been reading the Gospels. She said, "What does this mean? Who is this person?" And now here she is, a United Methodist minister. What a change, what a transformation, because we saw, this group saw beyond those human imposed boundaries. We're willing to go to Russia to proclaim the good news, to do God's work in this world. Sometimes our boundaries are not so obvious. 3 and 4 years ago, people were telling us, "Oh, you need to start live streaming your service and reach the online congregation." And I thought about it, and you know me, I'm not tech shy. But I thought, I don't think that works for us. I don't see that being a way for us to go forward. Yeah, right. Here we are. Our Facebook group is the largest congregating worshiping body we have together. See, I had a limit there. And God said, "Oh no, you need to see past that." God calls us to do so much. And I love the United Methodist Church because we are a big tent denomination. We have some boundaries, but they're pretty wide, and there's a lot of room within there. We don't have to agree on everything. It saddens me that some people feel that we do, and yet, as United Methodists, we are allowing them to leave. It's like, you feel strongly about this, you can't work with us in this way, then go forth with a blessing. I'm hoping many that leave will come back, because we are the less for them, as well as they are. John Wesley disagreed with Whitfield, but remained friends. He saw that Whitfield was doing good. Paul went beyond his self-imposed cultural limits, his geographic limits. And thus Lydia became the first convert in Europe, a strong supporter of the church. So my question this morning for you: where is God calling you? Is God calling you to Macedonia? Someplace new or different? Some different way of doing things? Some people that need to hear what you have to tell them? Or are you resisting, saying, "Oh, God can't be there"? Will you pray with me? Lord, speak to us. for we, your servants, are listening. Amen.
Theologian Stanley Hauerwas said, "We are resident aliens living in the world." The word alien sometimes strikes us as too foreign, unbelonging. Some immediately jump to little green men from outer space. Others may think of immigrants who are derogatorily called illegal aliens. The Bible addresses Abram and Sarai as aliens called out of Haran to Canaan. God calls us to leave our own comfort zones and travel into the world to explore where the woundedness may be so we can bring healing and acceptance. As we come together to share our joys and our concerns, may we leave the protected shelter of our own contentment to see the world through God's eyes. This morning, when you hear me say, "Lord, send your spirit," we invite you to respond even from your own homes with the words, "and renew your people." This time of being able to pray together aloud, even if we are in our own spaces, gives us the opportunity to combine corporately with one another as we worship God. Let us pray. God of all people, you draw us into the world to serve. The beauty overwhelms our senses. Your glory is seen from the first streaks of dawn through the brightness of day to the setting sun and through the night of darkness. Awaken our senses to experience you anew. Lord, send out your spirit and renew your people. All creation lives to praise you, O God. As the earth yields its blessing, may we honor and protect the precious gifts of nature and give thanks for the beauty, healing, and sustenance it provides for all. Lord, send out your spirit and renew your people. You bless your church throughout all the ages with leaders like Paul and Lydia, John Wesley and Francis Asbury, to share in the spreading of the gospel. Give to your church this day a profound sense of the mission to which you now call us for the life and health of the world. Lord, send out your spirit and renew your people. You judge the people with equity and guide the nations of the earth. Give to all leaders and people the gift of wisdom and the spirit of peace, that we may walk by your light as we serve the common good. Lord, send out your spirit and renew your people. You promise to be with us always through the comfort of your Holy Spirit. Give to all who suffer violence, grief, or pain an enduring trust in Jesus that joy will rise again. We pause to lift the names of those on our hearts this day. Lord, send out your spirit and renew your people. We give thanks for the many blessings of our lives, that as we follow Jesus, he journeys with us day by day through the presence of your Holy Spirit, our advocate and teacher. Lord, send out your spirit and renew your people. You are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. You send us out to serve, and we answer with our lives and actions, and if necessary, our words, "Here I am." And so we pray to you along with the communion of saints, just as Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Thank you.
Today, we want to lift up our Neighbors Feeding Neighbors program. They are continuing to bring food to our children in the local elementary schools and making sure they have food to get them through the day and give them energy and to tell them that they are loved. Let us give God thanks. For all you have given us, we thank you, gracious God, for day and night, evening and morning, for land and sea, for fish and birds, plants and animals, for humankind, and for your Son, who came among us with the gift of life abundant. Let your Holy Spirit abide in our midst and work through our gifts, that all people may have joy and peace. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace in your going out and in your coming in your sitting down and in your rising up, in your work and in your play, in your joy and in your sorrow, in your laughter and in your tears, until that day comes which is without dawn and without dark. Amen.
In the name of the Creator, whose world groans for justice, and in the name of the Christ, whose resurrection teaches us that all are worthy, and in the name of the Great Spirit, whose constant flow leads us toward righteousness. Amen.